So here we are starting with the cardiovascular system examination. So for cardiovascular system examination, first we have to do the general examination. Some points of the general examination which are important for the cardiovascular system proper, like we have to examine for the pallor, we have to examine for the cyanosis, for the clubbing, for the edema, for the ascites, and for the vital signs also. General examination proper has been covered in separate video. So here we are not going to discuss in detail. Now come to the systemic examination. For cardiovascular system, we have to do examination of the radial pulse, examination of the JVP, measurement of the blood pressure, and then examination of the pericardium proper. Again, we have made separate videos for radial pulse, for examination of JVP, and measurement of blood pressure. So here we are going to discuss the examination of the pericardium proper. So come to the examination of the pericardium. So for that we need to know what is pericardium. So pericardium is the area of the chest which is overlying heart and great vessels. So for the examination of the pericardium, we have to start with the inspection. So for that, first we have to look at the prerequisites of the examination. So for cardiovascular system examination, we must stand on the right side of the subject, and then your patient must lie in such a way that head end should be elevated at about 45 degrees. Okay, and then you have to look at the pericardium. Either you look standing on the right side tangentially, or you can stand on the foot end of the subject like this, and then you have to look for the position of the pericardium like this. Okay, now first point we have to see is you have to look for the shape of the chest or pericardium. Shape of the chest, normal shape of the chest is elliptical. Different abnormal shapes of the chest I have already covered in respiratory system examination. Here we'll focus more on the pericardium. So here in my subject, like there is no pericardial bulging or depression. Now, what are the causes of the pericardial bulging? Now we know that some cases of the pericardial effusion, in cases of the right ventricular dilatation, in some cases of the bronchogenic carcinomas, in some cases of the scoliosis, there is pericardial bulging. Pericardial depression may also be present, and pericardial depression leads to the compressive effects on the heart, or it may also lead to the deviation of the apex beat. So it may be one of the cause of the deviation of the apex beat to any side. So this is about the shape of the chest or pericardium. Next is distended vessels. So many times distended vessels or distended veins are present over the chest, but they are present mostly whenever there is superior or inferior vena cava obstruction. Okay, due to any reason, if there is superior or inferior vena cava obstruction, maybe because of any aneurysm which is obstructing the deep vein, or any carcinoma or any bronchogenic carcinoma or any other carcinoma which is obstructing the deep vein will lead to the distension of the superficial veins. So mostly superficial veins are visible in lateral part of the chest. So that is not present in my patient, in my subject. So there is absence of any engorged superficial vein. Now come to the position of trachea. In case if trachea is grossly deviated, it will be visible on inspection only. So aap thoda uthkar baith jayenge, seedhe dekhiye, sar upar kariye. So on inspection we can see there is no gross deviation of the trachea. Let jaiye apni position pe. Now we look for any scar marks or sinuses. We know that in case if there is any midline scar mark, so that signifies any sternotomy which was done previously during bypass surgeries or aortic valve replacement. If there is presence of any scar mark in submammary area, okay, here, if there is presence of scar mark in submammary area, that signifies mitral valvotomy. okay, if scar mark is present below the clavicle, it signifies placement of any defibrillator or any pacemaker. So if pacemaker is placed, then in that case bulge may also be visible over the chest. So this is about the scar mark. Sinuses may be present in cases of old tuberculosis. So we have to look for the scar marks in sinuses. Then to look for the apical impulse or cardiac impulse. So apical impulse is the lowermost, outermost and most definite impulse in the precordial area. So we have to look for that in our subject. So come here. So I can see there is an impulse. You have to look tangentially. There is an impulse visible below the left nipple. Okay, and that is medial to the midclavicular line. So I will not count intercostal spaces here because that I will confirm in the palpation only. So here a pulsation is visible in the left, below the left nipple. So that is apical impulse. Actually, there are some cases, normally also apical impulse is not visible in some cases when there is obesity, or apical impulse is hidden behind the rib. So in those cases also apical impulse may not be visible normally. Okay, so now we have to look for the other pulsations. So other pulsations or other impulses in the precordial areas. So for that we must know what are the main precordial areas. So let us come to our subject. So focus on the chest. So this is sternal angle. Okay, from sternal angle there is second rib which is attached. This is sternal angle, second rib which is attached. So this is second intercostal space. So in second intercostal space, in second left intercostal space, there is pulmonary area. In second right intercostal space, there is aortic area. In fifth left intercostal space, just medial to the midclavicular line, there is mitral area. And mitral area will be at the apical impulse or apex beat. Now tricuspid area, which is present just left to the sternum in the fifth intercostal space. So these are four main cardiac areas, okay, in which we have to look for the different pulsations. Now pulsations, what are the conditions in which these pulsations will be present? So let us see. In case if pulsations are visible in the aortic area, so that will be present in case of the aortic aneurysm. In case if they are present in the pulmonary area, so that will be present in case of the pulmonary hypertension or pulmonary dilatation. Okay, in case if pulsations are present in the epigastric area, so in epigastric area normally also pulsations are present in the lean and thin person, especially if he is nervous. Okay, in left parasternal area, pulsations may be present in case of the right ventricular hypertrophy. Pulsations in the suprasternal notch may be present in cases of the aneurysm of arch of aorta or dilatation of arch of aorta. So these are the causes of, you know, abnormal pulses which may be present in the precordial areas. Now we come to next part of cardiovascular system examination, that is palpation. So in palpation, what is the first thing to do is the examination of the shape of the chest. So examination of the shape of the chest is done. Already we have seen in inspection, and now we will confirm shape of the chest by palpation. So let us see how to see. For that we need to measure the anterior posterior and transverse diameter of the chest. So let us see how to measure the anterior posterior diameter of the chest. For that you have to take two cardboards. Okay, and you have to put the cardboards like this, and now you have to measure the distance between two cardboards. Now this is the transverse diameter of the chest. To measure the anterior posterior diameter, you have to put cardboards like this. You have to put cardboards like this, by which you can measure the anterior posterior diameter of the chest, okay, with the help of inch tape. Now we can see that transverse diameter is more than the anterior posterior diameter. So shape of the chest is elliptical, and that is normal. We can see there is no precordial depression or precordial bulging also. Now come to the second part of the palpation, that is palpation for the tenderness. थोड़ा सा लेट For that the patient is lying either supine or at 45 degrees. So you have to do palpation for the tenderness. For that the palpation is done in whole of the chest, but particularly in areas where there is any scar mark or swelling or at the costochondral junctions. So in case if there is any swelling, you have to palpate that area especially for the tenderness. Or in case if there is any scar mark, you have to palpate that area and costochondral junctions like this. Okay, so what are the common causes of the presence of tenderness over the chest? So the common causes are costochondritis, myalgia, fracture of the rib, and many other causes are there. Now come to the next point of palpation, that is direction of flow in the vessels. So what we do for the direction of flow in the vessels, for that we need to see, suppose if there are superficial vessels present over the chest, so what we do, although there is no superficial vein in my subject, main thoda sa ise I am drawing vein like structure. Suppose this is one vein, one superficial vein, tortuous vein, which is visible over the chest. So how we'll see the direction of flow in this vein? So what we'll do, we will put two fingers. So I'll put two fingers and squeeze the vein like this. The vein will become empty and then I will release the upper finger. Okay, suppose the vein fills, it means the direction of the flow was from above downwards. Suppose the vein is not getting filled, then I will release the lower point. Okay, now in case if it is filling, it means the direction of the flow was from below upwards. So that is how we can measure the direction of flow in the veins. So what is importance of the direction of flow in the superficial vein? Actually, the direction of the flow in the superficial vein is similar to the vein which has been obstructed, due to which this superficial vein has been opened. Suppose if there is obstruction of the superior vena cava, then direction of this superficial vein will be from above downwards. Okay, and if there is obstruction of the inferior vena cava, the direction of the flow will be from below upwards. Okay, so that is importance of the direction of flow in the superficial veins. Now the next point of the examination is assessment of the position of trachea. Now we'll see how to assess the position of trachea. So let us come to our subject. Your subject must be sitting while assessing position of trachea. For that you have to put your index finger and ring finger over the sternoclavicular joint, and you have to trace the trachea with the middle finger, and you have to look at the distance between the middle finger and index finger and middle finger and ring finger. So these two distances are equal, so we can say that the position of trachea is central. Now another matter is that you put your index finger and middle and ring finger in the similar way on the sternoclavicular joints of both the sides, and you have to insert your middle finger in the space between the sternocleidomastoid muscle and the trachea. Okay, like this. Okay, thoda sa gardan niche kare. In the space between the sternocleidomastoid muscle and trachea, so these two spaces are equal. So with that we can say that the position of the trachea is central. Now we must know what are the causes of deviation of position of trachea. So in case if there is any pulling pathology like pulmonary fibrosis, collapse of lung, so that will lead to deviation of trachea to the same side. Okay, but in case if there is any pushing pathology like pneumothorax, pyothorax, pleural effusion, so that will lead to pushing of trachea to the opposite side. So these are the common causes of deviation of trachea. We come to assessment of the apex beat. Assessment of the apex beat is one of the most important part of the cardiovascular system examination. So for that we must know what is apex beat. So apex beat is lowermost and outermost most definite pulsation which is present over the precordium. So what are the things we must know about the apex beat? One is location of the apex beat, second is extent of the apex beat, then amplitude or force of the apex beat, and then is the duration of the apex beat. Now come to the location of the apex beat. So normally apex beat is located in the fifth intercostal space. Sometimes it may be present in the fourth intercostal space also. So usually it is medial to the midclavicular line. So what is midclavicular line? Midclavicular line is the vertical line drawn from the point between the sternoclavicular joint and acromioclavicular joint. So this is about the midclavicular joint. So apex beat is present mostly at or medial to the midclavicular line. Now come to the extent of the apex beat. So normally apex beat is limited to the one intercostal space and diameter is usually less than the 2.5 centimeters. So now we must know what is the amplitude of the apex beat. Amplitude or force of the apex beat. So normally amplitude of the apex beat is low and it is brisk and tapping. So normal force or amplitude of the apex beat is low, it is brisk and tapping. Next point we must know about the apex beat is duration of the apex beat. So duration of the apex beat is in the initial 2/3 of the systole. It should be less than initial 2/3 of the systole. So it should not be touching the S2. So we can see in this diagram, it should not be touching S2. Now, what are the abnormal location, extent, amplitude and duration about the apex beat? So, what are the conditions in which the apex beat will be deviated? So, apex beat may be shifted in case pathologies of the lung, like there is pulmonary collapse or fibrosis of the lung. So, that will lead to the shifting of the apex beat to the same side. But that shifting will be along with the shifting of trachea. In case if there is any pushing pathology in lung like pleural effusion, pneumothorax or pyothorax, so that will lead to pushing of apex beat to the opposite side. But that shifting will always be along with the shifting of trachea. But there are some conditions like left ventricular enlargement and scoliosis. So these are the conditions in which only apex beat will be shifted, not the trachea. So these are the causes of shifting of apex beat or change in the location of the apex beat. Okay, so next is extent of the apex beat. Usually apex beat is limited to the one intercostal space, but there are some conditions like left ventricular dilatation in which apex beat may be in more than one intercostal spaces, like 2 or 3 intercostal spaces. Okay, next is amplitude of the apex beat. So here it is normal amplitude. So apex beat force or amplitude may be increased in some conditions, and that type of the apex beat is called as hyperkinetic apex beat. So normally it may found in any anxious or nervous person or after exercise. There are some pathological conditions like hyperthyroidism and left ventricular enlargement in which the apex beat becomes hyperkinetic or force of the apex beat increases. Okay, there are some conditions in which force of the apex beat decreases or apex beat is feeble, like in conditions of the left ventricular dilatation in which the apex beat becomes feeble. Next is duration. So normal duration is less than 2/3. So there are some conditions in which the apex beat is occupying approximately whole of the systole and it is touching the S2. So this is called as sustained apex beat, which is found in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So these are the abnormal conditions related to the apex beat. Now we'll see how we assess the apex beat in our subject. So let us come to our subject. So what are the prerequisites for the assessment of the apex beat? So your subject must be lying at 45 degrees, head end must be elevated at 45 degrees, and you must stand on the right side, light must be adequate, and exposure must be at least up to the waist. So here I'll put my hand, flat of hand, over below the left nipple like this, and I will try to feel the most prominent pulsation. At the site of most prominent pulsation, I'll put the ulnar side of my hand like this, and again at the site of most prominent pulsation, I will put the pulp of my index and middle finger like this. Okay, now I will count the intercostal space at the sternal angle. This is sternal angle. So at the sternal angle there is attachment of the second costal cartilage, below which there is second intercostal space, again below which there is third, this is fourth, and this is fifth. So apex beat is localized in the fifth intercostal space. This is the midclavicular line, so it is just medial to the midclavicular line. Force is normal, it is brisk, tapping limited to the one intercostal space, and diameter is about 2 cm. So this is about the apex beat. Now in case if you are not able to palpate the apex beat, here I am able to palpate the apex beat, but in case if you are not able to palpate the apex beat, then you ask your subject to turn to the left lateral position. Thoda sa us taraf mud jaiye. Left lateral position like this, and you try to feel for the apex beat. Okay, seedha ho jaiye. Suppose if you are not able to palpate, then you ask your subject to sit down. Please baith jaiye thoda sa. Okay, like this. And in case if you are not able to palpate still, then you ask your subject to lean forward. थोड़ा आगे झुक जाइए आगे की तरफ, हाँ थोड़ा और. So in this condition, heart comes near to the anterior chest wall, so it becomes easier to palpate for the apex beat. But this all you have to do only when you are not able to palpate at 45 degrees. Okay, so you can use both the positions. Like first you do in the 45 degrees, head end should be elevated at 45 degrees. Suppose you are not able to palpate, that you turn your patient to the left lateral position. And or you can do that you ask your subject to sit down and lean forward. So you can assume both the positions, left lateral position and sitting position. Okay, so in both these condition you can palpate the apex beat. Although there are some conditions in which the apex beat is not palpable, like when apex, in case of any obese or muscular person, or many times the apex beat is hidden behind the rib. So these are the normal conditions in which the apex beat is not palpable. There are some pathological conditions like pleural effusion, left-sided pleural effusion, and pericardial effusion. So in that case also apex beat may not be palpable. In case if there is dextrocardia, in that case apex beat will be shifted to the right side. Okay, so these are the causes of impalpable apex beat. Part of the palpation, that is heave. So what is heave? Heave are the sustained impulses. Okay, so heave are the sustained impulses which are produced because of enlargement of the left ventricle or right ventricle or atrium or ventricular aneurysm. So it can be felt at the precordium. So most common cause of the heave, presence of the heave over the chest, is right ventricular enlargement, for which we are going to palpate the left parasternal area. So heave of the right ventricular enlargement is present over the left parasternal area. Now which part of the hand we can feel for the heave? So either with the ulnar border of the hand or with the ulnar border of the palm. Okay, or base of the hand or heel of the hand, like this. So ulnar border of the hand, ulnar border of the palm, and heel of the palm. Okay, this is heel of the palm. So these are the areas with which we can feel the heave in a better way. So let us see in our subject. So I will palpate the left parasternal area with the heel of the palm, like this. Or you can feel with the ulnar border of the palm like this, or you can put the ulnar border of the hand like this. So like this you feel for the heave or sustained impulses. So there is no heave in my subject. So this was about the heave. Now come to the thrill. What is thrill? Thrill is the tactile equivalent of the murmur, or in other words, I can say that it is the palpable murmur. In case if the murmur is of high grade, it produces the thrill. Okay, so let us see how we palpate for the thrill. We palpate thrill with the flat of the hand, especially base of the fingers. we can feel the thrill with the flat of the hand, especially base of fingers. So we have to palpate whole of the precordial area. Okay, so let us see how you palpate. This is for the aortic area. This is for the pulmonary area. This is tricuspid area. And this is the mitral area. So with the flat of the hand, especially base of the fingers, I am feeling for the thrill. So in case if there is presence of thrill, I'll feel a kind of vibration. Okay, vibration kind of feeling will be there. So which is not present in my subject. So why thrill is produced? Thrill is produced because of turbulent flow of the blood. And it is produced especially when the patient is holding his breath at the end of the expiration. So it is felt in a better way in that position. So in case if you want to feel the thrill, whether it is systolic or diastolic, what you are supposed to do, you put the thumb of your hand over the carotid artery and you feel for the thrill. So by that you will come to know the thrill is systolic or diastolic. So what are the common causes of the thrill? The causes which will produce the murmur may produce thrill. Like if there is patent ductus arteriosus or aortic stenosis or ventricular septal defect. So these are the causes, these are the common causes of thrill over the chest. To the next part of the cardiovascular system examination, that is percussion. Now percussion is relatively less important part of the cardiovascular system examination, but some things may be asked in the MBBS first year examination in the form of OSCE, like trace the right or left border of the heart. So let us see in our subject how I will trace the right and left border of the heart. So you must know all the prerequisites, like your subject must lie at 45 degree, means head end must be elevated at 45 degrees, and exposure must be adequate up to the waist, and light must be adequate. Then for tracing the left border of the heart, first you need to locate the apex bead. I have already explained in my video that how you will locate the apex bead. Suppose I have located the apex bead here in the fifth intercostal spaces. Focus here. So suppose your apex bead has been located in the fifth intercostal space. Then, okay, you will, main thoda mark kar lu ise, you will first, mark the apex bead. Like this, and then you count the intercostal space. This is sternal angle at which the second rib is attached. This is below which there is second intercostal space. This is second, this is third, this is fourth, and apex bead was there in the fifth intercostal space. Okay, so now you have to do percussion. So percussion for the left border of the heart, you have to start from lateral to the medial and start from the mid axillary line. Here I am getting resonant note at the site of apex bead. There is dull note, I have already marked. Now go one intercostal space above. This is resonant, this is resonant, again resonant. You have to follow all the rules of the percussion, like you have to do the movement at the wrist joint. Okay, here it is dull. So again I will mark the point of dullness. This is the point of dullness at fourth intercostal space. One more space above, I'll come from lateral to the medial. This is resonant, again this is resonant, again this is resonant, and here it is dull. So these are three points. One was at the apex bead, fifth intercostal space. This was on the fourth intercostal space, and this is in the third intercostal space, lateral which there was resonant note. So you will stop at the point where you got the dull note. So you have to come at least two intercostal spaces above the apex bead.
this was the fifth, and this is the fourth, this is third. So you have to come at least two intercostal spaces above the apex bead. You can come one more space, but this much is sufficient. So you have to join these three points. So this is the left border of the heart. This is the left border of the heart. You can make one more point in the second intercostal space like this. So this is in the second intercostal, which is very near to the external border. Okay, so at least two points you have to come above the apex bead. So this is the left border of the heart. Now come to the how you will trace the right border of the heart. So for tracing the right border of the heart, first you have to start percussion, okay, and you have to come downwards, because first you wanted to know the boundary of the liver. So for liver dullness, first I will start, you know, in the second intercostal space. This is resonant, this is resonant, second, third, fourth, again resonant. In fifth I got the dull note, probably it is the liver dullness. So I will go three intercostal spaces above the intercostal space of the liver dullness. So I got the liver dullness in the fifth intercostal space. So I will go in the three spaces, fourth, third and second. So how you will do? You will go again from lateral to the medial, but this time you will not go from the mid axillary line. This time you will go from the mid clavicular line. So let us see. So, you know, this is second. So I will go from lateral to the medial, starting from the mid clavicular line here. So here I got the dull note, okay, again I'll start in the third intercostal space from the midclavicular line, again this is resonant and this is the dull note, this is the dull note, okay, again I will do in the fourth intercostal space from lateral to medial and this is the point of dullness. So three intercostal spaces above the intercostal space of dullness. Okay, so you have to join all these three points, and this is the right border of the heart, which corresponds to the right border of the sternum. Okay, so right border of the heart corresponds to the right border of the sternum. Now you must know the causes of deviation of border of the heart. Like left border of the heart may be deviated in left ventricular hypertrophy, and right border of the heart can be deviated in the, you know, in the pericardial effusion and in the aortic aneurysm. So you must know the causes of deviation of borders of the heart. Now for tracing the upper and lower borders of the heart. Now upper border of the heart cannot be traced because heart is connected with the greater vessels. So these vessels will also give the dull note. And below, lower border of the heart cannot be traced. Why? Because this is in continuation with the diaphragm and the left lobe of the liver. So lower and upper border of the heart cannot be traced. So this is about the percussion of the precordium for CVS examination. Come to the auscultation of the precordium. So for auscultation of the precordium, we must know all four important areas for auscultation. So these areas are the mitral area, tricuspid area, pulmonary area and aortic area. So here in this diagram, you can see that this is, you know, pulmonary area, that is the left second intercostal spaces just few centimeter lateral to the left external border. This is pulmonary area. This is aortic area, lateral to the right external border in the second intercostal space. This is tricuspid area in the fifth intercostal space, just left to the sternum. This is mitral area, or this corresponds to the apex bead. This is again in the fifth intercostal space, just medial to the mid clavicular line. So these are all four areas of the precordium which has to be, you know, auscultated. To the heart sounds. So there are two heart sounds which are heard normally, S1 and S2. So you must know which part of the stethoscope you must use for listening these sounds. So this is, you know, broader part of the chest piece, that is diaphragm, with which you can listen the high pitch sounds like S1, S2, sounds of the mitral and aortic regurgitations. This is bell, this is bell, a smaller part of the chest piece with which you can hear the low pitch sounds like S3, S4 and sound of the murmur of the mitral stenosis. So let us come to these two sounds. One is S1 and second is S2. S1 is heard better at the apex of the heart. It means at the mitral area. So S1 is heard better in the mitral and tricuspid areas, while the S2 is heard better at the base. Base means at the second left and right intercostal spaces. It means at the aortic and pulmonary areas. So at S2 is heard better in the aortic and pulmonary areas, while S1 is heard better at the apex and in the tricuspid areas. So at S1 is heard better in these areas and S2 is heard better in these areas. And S1 corresponds to the starting of the systole. S2 corresponds to the starting of the diastole. S1 is produced due to the closure of the mitral and tricuspid valves. S2 is produced due to the closure of the aortic and pulmonary valves. Okay. Now there is physiological splitting in these sounds. Like S2 splits during the inspiration. Okay, while there is no splitting during expiration. Normally there is no splitting of S1, neither in inspiration nor in expiration. So S2 splits in A2 and P2, means aortic and pulmonary component, during the inspiration, while there is no splitting of S1. Now here we can see S1 is low frequency sound, S2 is high frequency sound. S1 corresponds to the R wave of ECG and S2 corresponds to the T wave of ECG. Okay, S1 with the R wave and S2 with the T wave. And S1 corresponds to the carotid pulsation. S2 comes after the carotid pulsation. So here let us see how to listen the S1 and S2 sounds in all four areas. Here, focus here on the chest. So with the bell of the with the diaphragm of the stethoscope, I will listen this sound in all four areas. This is the second right intercostal space, means aortic area. This is second left intercostal space, that is pulmonary area. Okay, this is second, third, fourth, fifth. Okay, left fifth intercostal space, just near to the left external border, is the tricuspid area, and again just medial to the midclavicular line in the fifth intercostal space, left side, it is the mitral area or apex. Okay, I am listening two sound, one is lub, second is dub. So S1 is lub and S2 sounds like dub. Okay, for differentiating these two sounds, I will put the thumb of my left hand over the right carotid artery. So S1 corresponds with the carotid pulsation and S2 comes after the carotid pulsation. Gehri saans lijiye aur chhodiye. So splitting of the S2 is heard during inspiration, but there is no splitting in S1. S1 is heard better in the mitral and tricuspid areas, but S2 is heard better in the pulmonary and aortic areas. So this is about the S1 and S2 sound.